All right, everybody, hello and welcome to the Nostalgia Trap. My name is David Parsons. Thanks so much for listening to the show. I very much appreciate it, and I hope you enjoy the conversation I have for you today. We talk a lot on this show about history, obviously. I'm a historian myself. But we talk not just about the content of history on the show, but the discipline of history, too. That means, what is it like to be a historian in the 21st century? What is it like to get a Ph.D. in history in the 21st century? I think if you listen to this show at all, or you know anything about the state of academia, you know it's not fun to get a Ph.D. in history in the 21st century because the job market fucking sucks. There's no place for us. There are now hundreds of people graduating with Ph.D.s every year in history with nowhere to go except kind of patching together lives within the gig economy of increasingly shitty part-time jobs at colleges and other institutions across the United States. So it's ugly out there. And my guest today can certainly attest to that world of a kind of shrinking set of opportunities for us. I went to school with Brendan O'Malley. Brendan O'Malley and I both went to the City University of New York Graduate Center. We knew each other there. We were in classes. We talk about that in this episode. And we had good memories of our classes together. And Brendan is someone who, you know, I read the opening kind of stages of his dissertation, which I'm hoping will be published as a book sometime soon, about Castle Garden Immigration Center, which is, I think, the world's first immigration center in New York City, predating Ellis Island. Really, really important work that he's doing. And his story is incredible because, you know, one of the elements of going to school, graduate school, during a precarious time is, you know, you and also having social media is you get to see, you know, where everybody ends up over the years. And over the years since Brendan and I both graduated from the CUNY Graduate Center, you know, I've watched, you know, everybody's fate kind of go through, some people getting full-time jobs, some people dropping out of academia altogether, some people doing podcasts like me to try to survive in addition to like being adjuncts at a number of different colleges and institutions, etc. So there's a lot of different paths that people are taking. And Brendan's path is, you know, I remember seeing on Facebook, I think, his announcement that he got a full-time job at this place, Newberry College. I looked it up immediately. I saw that it was a small liberal arts college in Brookline, Massachusetts, right outside of Boston. In his Facebook announcement, he said, you know, I'm heading back to where I'm from. And I thought, that's such a great thing. I was very happy for Brendan. You know, there are other people that I would be not happy about. Jealous, bitterness, rage at the people I felt that didn't deserve full-time jobs. That happens too. But that certainly wasn't the case with Brendan. I was happy that he got to go to Boston, where I knew where he was from. He was a Red Sox fan, etc. So I thought that was a really great thing that he got that job. But then something happened. And if you read his piece in Contingent Magazine, you know what's coming. The school closed. It's a small private liberal arts college, and those are, you know, some of the places that are, you know, really not making it. And then he explains exactly what happened with the school. But it closed, and Brendan found himself having to look for another job in a hurry. And his story is an incredible one. I think it's kind of a crazy, tragic story on one end in terms of the school and what happened to it, and Brendan's experience there, and the students' experience, and everyone else there. But it's also, for me, one of, you know, survival and the idea that, you know, Brendan's was able to transfer his skills and still be a historian and still be a teacher in another institution. And he'll tell you exactly how that happened. And I think it's an instructive lesson for all of us and a hopeful one for me, certainly, because I don't know where I'm going to end up. I'm still adjuncting and you know, there are possibilities to adjunct forever. You know, and I don't know if that's going to be my path, so we'll see. But either way, I hope you enjoy Brendan's story. It's an important one. And go check out Contingent Mag, because all their stuff is really, 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 really cool. And within this whole world of kind of historians and other academics that are trying to come to terms with a world and a society that isn't really giving value to our work and how we find that value somewhere else. So speaking of value, you know, I bring this podcast to everyone because you know, one of the, I want to do history and I want to, you know, bring these conversations to a wider audience. So, you know, I have a Patreon at patreon.com/nostalgiatrap. The people who support this show keep this whole program alive and help support my work as I try to, you know, survive in the same history market that everyone else is. So if you can throw a few bucks my way, it helps out a lot. And I've got bonus material. We've got bookshelf episodes where I talk about the books that shaped my consciousness. I think the latest episode we've got up was is about Michael Ayer's Dispatches about the Vietnam War. And we've got a bunch of other bonus episodes going back years if you subscribe. So go subscribe. It would help us a lot. Patreon.com/nostalgiatrap. Thank you, thank you, thank you to the people who are listening and supporting the show. And I hope you enjoy this episode. Here is me talking to historian Brendan O'Malley. Okay, Brendan O'Malley, thank you so much for joining me. I really appreciate it. When I think of your name, I have fond memories of the CUNY Graduate Center and our years studying history there. But thanks for coming on and sharing your story with me.
My pleasure, David. You know, I miss hanging out not only with you, but, you know, everybody at the GC. So there's a bit of a nostalgia aspect to this conversation for me as well.
100%. The thing that I remember, I mean, there's a lot of things I remember about you. I think you came in the year after me. I think did you start there in 2005?
That's right. Yeah.
So and I was looking. Yeah, so you were the young up and comer. And I thought it was the first time I had an idea that there would be like more generations of cohorts coming in. And I remember just being like incredibly impressed by the level of your research. Like I was like, I felt vaguely threatened by it because you're one of those people that studied the 19th century, if I'm correct. And you had real already like grasp of like city records and archives and things like that.
Well, that largely came out of the fact that I worked in academic book publishing for almost 10 years before that. So I had been working with historians and, you know, I just came in with this tremendous arrogance that was quickly like, you know, having to actually, I was like, oh, sure, I could do this myself. And then the research I actually enjoy, but the writing part just kicks my ass. Like it still does. I'm a very slow writer. And like, you know, I when I actually had to put it, you know, to the test at the GC early on, it was kind of the difficult having worked on other people's writing and enjoying that and finding that, you know, kind of easy to do the writing myself. And maybe having worked with all these incredible historians as an editor before, it was almost kind of stultifying for me in some ways. It made the writing even harder. And at the same time, folks at the grad center, like, you know, who I had met through publishing, like David Nassau, had pretty high expectations for me, which I quickly crushed. So
why do you say you quickly crushed them? You graduated, man. I mean, not everyone did.
I made it through. It took me 10 damn years, but I find writing very painful and I'm very slow and I'm just not able. And then there are a couple of people in the program who did make it through well before I did, who just are just natural born writers. You know what I mean? People who can really pump it out with this beautiful prose. And I still find writing really painful and challenging.
Yeah, no, I agree. I mean, everything that I wrote in that dissertation seminar that you and I took together, in which when I first encountered your work on Castle Garden and immigration detention, which I want to get into. But literally everything I wrote and like passed around to everybody, I threw all of that away. Like none of that even went into the dissertation, let alone the like published book. And I wish more people knew that weren't in academia or heading towards that there's a lot of trial and error and you throw a ton away. And that part of it is excruciating.
It is. But, you know, but then some people like, you know, not that I've published a lot. I've just done like a couple book chapters and I will finish the book manuscript at some point.
You better, dude. It's so relevant.
Yeah, it is. I mean, it is. And there's a whole coterie of people who are doing this kind of work in immigration history right now. Mm-hmm. You know, a mutual friend of ours, Carl Linskoog, among it, that just It's like bringing the state into the equation in a way that the old social history of immigration did not, which is really exciting to me. But
what do you mean? You know, what do you mean by that? Bringing the state in? Because I think I know what you mean. But like when I think of social history of immigration, I mean, it's a lot of the stuff that we were trained on was that kind of social history idea where you kind of look at history through the fabric of people's ordinary lives. And that's how you kind of tell the story. But what do you mean by that, the idea of bringing the state in?
Really more political history and, you know, history of government kind of, you know, analysis that the flows and, you know, the experience that people had, like, you know, beginning with folks like, you know, Oscar Handlin, you know, who did so much to, like, painstakingly recreate the lives of, you know, almost entirely European immigrants, right? Mm-hmm. From the consensus history immigration stuff, really where the field like Carl Witke and all these folks writing in the 40s, 50s, they were focused on this kind of archetypal European peasant, right? You know, coming through Ellis Island, because that was kind of what was kind of relevant to them right now. But, you know, that leads, and there was this book that came out, it's a Routledge book, Almost All Aliens by this guy, Paul Spicard, that came out probably about 10, 15 years ago, making fun of what he called this Ellis Island genre of social history.
Right.
Plus, and then, of course, you know, you have How the Irish Became White and the whole whiteness studies of the 1990s. And it kind of led to a dead end in immigration history for a while. But the way out, to my mind, and people like really amazing scholar, interesting guy, Hidetaka Hirota, whose book Expelling the Poor came out about 2-3 years ago, really bring – how do you escape out of this trap and like, you know, of the sort of typical paradigm set up by Handlin and, you know, the sort of social history of immigration folks is really through the state and looking through what the state does and the restrictiveness of it and Maynai's, you know, the Impossible Subjects is like kind of the founding book in this kind of subgenre that's kind of taken off, you know what I mean, where she combined, and Hidetaka Hirota does the same thing, combining social history with political history and history of government. And
that's,
you know,
great. So that's, I mean, that's that, to me, like, I mean, I've been to Ellis Island. I went there with my parents expecting like a, you know, a day of just kind of light tourism, and instead we encountered like this horrific story, but it was really told through the eyes of immigrants and really kind of on the ground of like almost like taking for granted that like this experience, this oppressive institution that they were being they were being like kind of pushed through was just kind of there. In other words, it wasn't interrogated at all why that existed.
Right. And in the fact that, you know, the quota system, you know, that begins with the Emergency Quota Act of 1921 and the National Origins Act of 1924 basically shut down immigration almost entirely. Except for Northern Europeans, right? It's insanely racist, right? And of course, the logic of this racial exclusion begins even before the Chinese Exclusion Act, the 1875 Page Act, like, which basically cut off all Chinese women from coming in, so therefore there couldn't be any natural-born citizens, right? The problem of and it's funny because I just taught on the high school level, and we'll get to that later, a unit that sort of combined both immigration and Reconstruction history and sort of framing it around the question of citizenship and who gets citizenship and who doesn't.
That's great. That's awesome. Yeah.
And, you know, oh my God, it wasn't, you know, exactly to state standards, but that's a whole other set of challenges I'll talk about, you know, being a public school teacher now. But,
I want to trace that line because, one of the reasons I wanted to have you on the show is because your story is one that I think a lot of people don't know kind of what the world is like for history PhDs in the 21st century and the different kind of paths we take. And your story, is featured in a piece in Contingent Magazine called The Closure, and I'll link that piece with this episode. But, you know, you tell your whole story of kind of like, I'll give away the spoilers, is that, you know, you achieved what all of us were desperately hoping we would achieve out of graduate school, which is a tenure track, full-time job at a college teaching history, only to have a few years later the college close. And you to find yourself without a job. So I think that the, you know, going through a little bit step by step of how that happened, I think people will be interested in that. But also beyond just, well, things suck now, I'd like to kind of have some idea about how we all survive, because this is the world that I'm in. This is the world that so many of the people that are getting PhDs, particularly in the humanities in the last several years, are kind of like, okay, we've dealt with the idea that the job market is collapsing, et cetera, and there's a lot of different big problems with the structure of things, but we also are people that are trained to do history. And so what do we do? What do we do with ourselves?
I know.
And
I have to say that, you know, a PhD program in history ultimately prepares you poorly to be another kind of teacher, for instance. Like I knew from the beginning, you know, when, you know, we had talked about this before, that I love teaching. You know, I mean, that was evident. You know, the CUNY Grad Center where we both went. I mean, they link your funding to a pretty heavy teaching load from, you know, after the first year.
Yep. I was teaching about three classes a semester the entire time I was at the Graduate Center.
Yeah. It was even worse for me. Well, it was worse and better. The chair of the department at Brooklyn College, where I was teaching at the time, Chris Ebert, was such a champion. He was, you know, so helpful to me in that he was able to get me a lecturer line, which came with full benefits and, like, you know, not a bad salary.
Those are great. Yeah.
They were great, but they're only, I think the PSC, the faculty union, only allows this position for 3 years, I think. It may have only been 2 years, but Chris somehow worked his magic. I hope I don't get him in trouble to get me on a lecturer line for 3 years at Brooklyn College, which was great.
How many classes did you have to teach, though?
But it's a 5-5 load, David.
Oh, yeah.
And that's what I was trying to finish, and he actually lightened the load a little bit by putting me in a lecture hall, which counted as two, right? So, but then I had to go up and perform for 120 students at Brooklyn. You know, I can do it, and I'm, you know, I think I'm a semi-entertaining lecturer, and it was actually fun, and I like the dynamic of that in some weird way, but
I bet you're great at it, but I can say this. I bet just knowing you and knowing you from graduate school, I bet you put a lot of time into prep, because you're a thorough person and you're like a very good researcher. And I bet you took a lot of time to prep for those classes. And that takes so much energy and time away from your work as a historian.
Which took, I mean, everybody said that to me, Brendan, you care too much about the teaching.
I discovered the same thing, though. I mean, I really like to teach. I think I'm lucky in that sense, and maybe you are too, to be like, I actually like teaching. There were a lot of people in our cohort or people around me at the Graduate Center who were like, oh, the name of the game is getting away from teaching. But it wasn't like that for me. What is it about teaching that works for you?
This goes into a lot of pretty deep places for me.
Yeah.
It's a really fundamentally human kind of activity, and outside of you know, I like to think of it, you know, probably grandiosely, as a kind of one of the few truly, or at least hopefully in some places, non-capitalist spaces. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
It's this human relationship, and you really get to know the students, or at least the ones who are engaged, and the ones you're trying, you know, and the ones you're trying to engage in. That kind of psychological and emotional element to teaching, like, what can I do to get this guy or this woman, you know, how can I pull them in, and how can I see how can I make this relevant to them, and see, you know, that challenge to me is just is fascinating, and it's relentless, and it's never ending, and it's, you know, why, and this is something I've always felt about my teaching, is that you need to show why this information is something that you can use in your life and is practical to you. And I think I said this in the contingent piece about, you know, history and the humanities in general, you know, train people to see the broader context and sort of to be able to take on leadership roles. And that leadership is almost a bad word to me because of the, you know,
neoliberal connotations.
Exactly. But You know, at CUNY in Brooklyn College, I'm dealing mostly with kids who are from working class families, as I am now, and from first, second generation immigrant families. You know, people who, you know, the message is, oh, don't care about history, don't care about political science, don't care about philosophy. You know, that's not really relevant to your life, but. You know,
well, I mean, it's easy to, I think in our culture, it's very easy to kind of like roast and make fun of like that, you know, the romanticization of education, because it seems like an old fashioned idea to, but the kind of the impulse, and it's very easy to kind of fall into a kind of sentimentalism about it. But like what you're describing is very close to how I would say why I like teaching too. You know, it's a fundamentally human activity, and it's something that an experience that I feel like always is enriching for everyone that's participating in
Absolutely.
It. And if it's not, then it's not working.
It's a hackneyed truism to say that you learn as much from your students as but it's not BS. It's really I mean, somebody who's interested in the immigrant experience and, you know, does immigration history, most of the students at, you know, at Brooklyn College and where I currently teach at the University Park Campus School in Worcester are, you know, from either immigrants themselves or their parents are. And, you know, that kind of interest on my behalf, you know, I don't know, just it's definitely affected my meager scholarly output and the, you know, how I think about, you know, immigration and when I write about it.
Oh yeah, I'm sure. I mean, you can't help that interface. I mean, I mention all the time the coffee houses in part because I realized that I'm really interested in like kind of, I don't know, space and how physical spaces can be charged with a certain kind of political or educational purpose. And so, yeah, the way that your scholarship interacts with your ideas about teaching, I think that's totally natural. But I wanted to get to your story of at what point did you, because like for all of us, it was like, you know, when we were at the Graduate Center finishing our PhDs, you think, okay, at what point do I go on the job market? At what point do I like start putting together my giant interfolio package of letters and sample syllabi and you name it. I mean, it's a ton of stuff. But like, at what point did you do that? Were you on the market for a long time before you got this job, or was it the first job you applied for?
No, I had applied to a lot of jobs throughout. I mean, it was funny during that it was really during the postdoc year that I truly, really went on the job market. My last year at the Graduate Center, I'd actually had one or two interviews. Once was at like Bronx Community College, but like, I think some folks were like not even sure I was gonna like actually finish when I said I was, and even though I ended up doing so, but there was some hesitancy that, you know, just because I had taken so damn long, and you know, I just the dissertation, the writing component was just a total struggle for me. You know, teaching a 5-5 load, having you know, our first, you know, kid born in 2010.
That's another part of the atomization that happened to people. Yep. We all got married and started families in the middle of all of this, and that was another level of time and stress and etc.
And I'm older than, you know, I started the program in my 30s.
Yep.
And you know, so there were certain expectations, you know. It was tough, that last thing, that last haul. So all my energy was really devoted, and the entire time through the writing process and finishing up was devoted to, you know, just the writing and the teaching. And that was basically it. So I applied for just a couple things within the CUNY system. I ultimately kind of hope to stay within Mother CUNY, as I call it.
Yeah, but, totally.
You know, and I did get an interview at the Bronx Community College, you know, BCC. Mm-hmm. And I think I kind of blew the demo lesson, but
God, I had so many experiences like that, dude. That just like I think I've purged them from my memories. I just say, oh, I never went to any interviews. It never happened to me.
And
it's an excruciating process. It really is.
But I really started to apply for a lot of things during my postdoc year. Okay. And it's funny because I thought the postdoc year, I was at the New York Historical Society jointly with the new school teaching one course each semester. It was like a one. I went from doing a 5-5 load at Brooklyn College to do a 1-1 load.
Amazing. And this
was teaching at Eugene Lang, and like for a salary that was like 15 grand more than I was making for doing the 5-5 load, which is just in itself just utterly absurd, right?
Some people get very cushy rides in academia, yeah, and some people, yeah, are literally busting their ass all day in academia for, right, dramatically different rates of pay. I mean, it's amazing.
And it just seemed so arbitrary and surreal, but I thought that I was going to get a ton of scholarship done, and maybe even get my manuscript in shape. And the people around me, like my fellow, an absolutely amazing scholar, I have enormous respect for her. She was able to basically finish her manuscript, but she was coming out of like Yale undergrad. She had gone to UMich, and she just had things all lined up in a way that I just could not get done because I just didn't have the resources or the Graduate Center, as much as I love many things about it, it did not give us the kind of resources and trainings and, you know, sort of expectations that folks come out of more, you know, I wouldn't, you know, obviously the Ivy programs, but
No, you're on your own at the CUNY Graduate Center. I mean, there's a lot of great stuff, but it's there was a lot of learning I had to do that took place just from like basically conversations in the hallway with people, yeah, like you, other graduate students, like, how do I do, yep, this? Where do I go? And like making those kind of social connections was really, yeah, the only way to survive job wise and otherwise in the program.
And it kind of blew my mind going at, because some of the other fellows who were at the New York Historical that year included Matt Karp from Princeton.
Yeah, yeah.
Dirk Hartog, who's now retiring, the legal, the kind of like the dean of legal history.
Mm-hmm.
Just all of these folks just comparing notes. I was like, why am I even here? Like, I don't have the same institutional pedigree. It was a real surreal experience. Like, and unfortunately that year I spent almost entirely just applying for jobs, and didn't really move the scholarship forward. And oh my God, the New York Historical people, if they hear this, they're not going to be happy with me for saying this, but it's true. It was just true. I did teach two awesome classes at, Eugene Lang, because all of the undergraduate seminars are designed by the instructor. There's no kind of core curriculum or anything. It's totally crazy at the new school, which it was great. The first semester I taught something called Citizenship in the Empire City.
Nice.
yeah, it was basically a history of New York City through the lens of citizenship, which was super fun. And then the second semester I taught something called Dirty Dealings, the dark or underside of capitalism during the long 19th century, which was also super fun. I mean, that was like...
Were these new school history majors that were in your class?
They were good, yeah. They weren't all history majors, the new school is a special place. It was, I had a super fun time teaching there.
That's a one good thing about there's other good things, but the kind of journeyman experience that you get being, an adjunct instructor at all these different schools and, you know, even, mm-hmm, like even getting fellowships and lectures, positions, yeah, and stuff like that is that, you know, you end up seeing a wide range of institutional atmospheres, if that makes sense. And institutional cultures, yep, but also like different kinds of students, etc. And I was at NYU Gallatin, like just incredible, mm-hmm, school, incredible students. I have lots to say about like problems with the school, etc., of course, but either, right, way, the experience of teaching at these places and really like, honestly, like all the other shit that comes around with it, I don't care about, right, it's the time in class, like, right, with the students really is what I value and really why I do,
yep,
it. Yeah.
I'm right there with you. Absolutely. 100%. And that's, you know, why I do what I do. But, you know, so I had this like cush gig, but it was only a 1 year, it was only 1 year. So, and it's funny, like people coming out of, they had a little bit of trouble filling stuff. It's 1 year at a fairly decent salary and it's a 1-1 load, but, people coming out of, bigger, kind of cushier programs really are looking for something that's a 2 or 3 year postdoc, just because it's impossible to get anything done in 1 year. So,
you're talking about two different impulses, right? I mean, that's a thing that took me a long time to understand, is that there were different kinds of scholars. Both, I mean, and it's like class and all the socioeconomic factors are part of it, but like there are people that like literally are in it to write books and like produce tons of research, and then there are people that are in it to teach and are just like their teaching is their thing. And that you don't really, because honestly, like devoting your energy to both of those things seems really almost impossible.
It is. I found that to be my experience. I knew I wanted, and even when the postdoc was over and it was late in the year and I still, you know, the traditional job market, I basically didn't come up with anything. This Newberry position opened up kind of late in the season, and I got called in for an interview there. And, and it was in the Boston area where I'm from originally. And, my parents live in the area. My sister lives in the area. I was kind of, let's give this a fly. And it sounded like, kind of more of a working class school in that, very teaching focus, a 4-4 load. I was kind of psyched about it. And so it worked out. I did a nice job with a demo lesson. I got hired there. And, it was painful to leave New York, but at least it was for, to a place that I'm fairly familiar with. And to be closer to my family, actually, I get along well with my parents. They're not typical former working class whites in their 70s. They're actually very progressive. My dad claims to be a socialist, although I don't think his bona fides are.
It's funny, you have a similar experience as me, because I came back to my hometown and I hang out with my parents now too. And my parents are not Trump people. And if they were, I don't know if I would be here. You know what I mean? Like, I don't know if it would, like, I'm not sure what my relationship would be like with them. They despise Trump, and they're not communists or anything like that. But they despise Trump, and that's enough for me now. Yeah.
Yeah. Same. No. Same. But what I liked about Newberry, and I said this in the Contingent piece, is that the faculty were teachers. They were teachers. There was a couple people who produced scholarship on a fairly regular basis, but there was this real cultural divide. There were the younger folks who all had terminal degrees, but then there were all these people, teaching there for like 25, 30 years, who were hired back in an era when the place barely had anybody with a terminal degree there. So there was this real divide in culture at there. But I love the older folks, because some of them were just tremendous teachers. Some of them were not, but there was a real emphasis on teaching, and I learned so much about the craft of teaching from quite a few of the folks who had been teaching there since 1976. So
tell me about this school. Like, what is this? Because I had never heard it. When I heard that you got this job at Newberry, I had to look it up. I was like, what school is this, and where did Brendan O'Malley get a job? Because we were all, it was such a, like, I don't know, it felt like such a like team victory when one of us got a tenure track job. But tell me about Newberry a little bit. Like, what?
It didn't have a traditional tenure system, but you were, if you got there and you didn't, you didn't mess up, you did a good, you would get into this like 5-year contract system, which I was definitely on the road to do. Mm-hmm. And it was total security, if the place hadn't closed, right? I hadn't heard of it either. And that's the funny thing, is I grew up when I was really little. We lived in Somerville, which is a city right next to Boston. And then we moved out to Needham when my dad got a job teaching Latin at Needham High School, which is a kind of cushy, bougie suburb of Boston. Mm-hmm. Not too far out of the city, though, like about 15, 20 miles out of the city, and on the commuter rail line, which was great for me because I could go into Kenmore Square and to the used record shops and see all ages shows and all the clubs and stuff like that when I was a kid. But
We have a whole indie rock show to do separately with you.
Oh, God. Yeah. When I was growing up, literally like 3 or 4 miles from this campus, I had never heard of it, because You know, I didn't go to Needham High because my dad taught there, and I get along with my dad, but I kind of felt weird about going to the place where he was kind of this big presence there. So I went to this private boys' school, which at the time was kind of cheap. You know, it was academically very rigorous and hard to get into, like test wise and everything like that. But it was when I was back there, it was like $5,000 or $6,000 a year. So, you know, my parents were both public school educators, so, you know, they could afford that. It was not too much skin off their backs. But it was an all boys school. It was founded in 1645, and it was very conservative in a lot of ways. And it wasn't like the best fit for me, you know, who was like a budding punk rocker kid, you know, drummer. And it was kind of an odd match for me. But all of the students in my graduating class, none of them went to Newberry College. Nobody had ever even heard of Newberry College. Same in Needham, though. Needham, nobody went there because it was all middle-class, bougie, upper-middle-class people. And this was a working-class school. It was primarily known when I was a kid, really, for culinary. It had a great culinary program. And it's still, the culinary program was still good when the school closed. The folks in the culinary, the faculty there were amazing. And I loved the culinary students. But it also, in the past, it had had degrees in like ophthalmic, dispensing, you know, optician kind of, you know.
Right, right.
Like the person who helps the actual eye doctor to dispense the glasses or, medical assistant kind of stuff. It was all like, you know, up and coming working class people who want to hit the next rung kind of place. That's what it was. And, you know, back as I wrote in the piece, like in the early 2000s, it tried to make itself into a liberal arts college. And, then the financial crisis hit and, you know, it just.
So it tried. So it sounds like that transition was, is that how in their kind of institutional history, you would, is that where the it did, in other words, that transition didn't succeed to a liberal arts college? Because that you said no. That happens in the 2000s?
Yeah, it sort of did because, you know, what I loved about the school and I loved about the students is that the kids, they generally were kids who kind of goofed off or messed up in college. And this is one of the few places that would let them in. You know what I mean?
Yeah, yeah. I mean, I'm learning about and this school. I mean, I wonder how representative it is of this kind of private liberal arts college, because part of my curiosity is about, you know, so many, when you go and look at jobs online, you find mm-hmm. a lot of colleges that you've never heard of and that you're right. Like, okay, what is this? And you look it up online, you kind of figure out, okay, it's been here for actually 100 years and, you know, right. It has a long history. It's hard, in other words, to figure out when it's a college in, I mean, this is for you, it's even from your hometown, like near your hometown, yeah. But let alone a state that you've never been to. I wonder, so at what point, in terms of being at the school, at what point do you begin to hear the first rumblings of like that there's might be institutional trouble with the school?
The first year, not so much. I mean, some of the folks, there was a communications professor. She very, very sharp, very kind of scholarly production kind of person. She left for a job and I was like, that's when I was like, oh. Because she, you know, she had served on various councils and worked with the president and, you know, done stuff on the faculty senate. And
when people like that jump ship, you begin to wonder.
Yeah, exactly. And then, that's when I started to pay attention to the enrollment numbers a little bit more at the faculty senate meetings. And by the end of the first year, I had a pretty good idea that,
end of the first year.
Yeah.
Wow.
Because I was.
Were you sweating at home over this? I mean, it seems like something that I'd be like, holy shit. Like I've relocated my family and now it's like a year in and it doesn't look great.
No. Yeah. It definitely loomed. I mean, we were sort of in denial about it a little bit. And in the first year was great. I actually had a fun time. The faculty, there was a certain camaraderie. I really liked my colleagues, my coworkers.
Yeah, that's the impression I got from your piece was not that you wound up at some nightmare school, but in fact that you had had like a good experience at this school, but then there was like kind of clouds forming about the survival of the school itself.
And I even like the administrators. They weren't like the typical, they were kind of folks from working class backgrounds who felt like they had made well. And, you know, maybe they didn't make a lot of the best decisions, but, you know, in all, I thought they were decent people. They weren't looking to, you know, just stick it to the faculty all the time. Like, you know, that was kind of the dynamic sometimes in CUNY. You had a very adversarial relationship between faculty and,
yeah, plenty of stories about that. I feel like it's a, you could do a whole podcast about, what, CUNY fights.
Oh, I know. And it bore most people to tears, but I mean,
yeah,
there's some extreme stuff, but this place, it was too small, and it was,
what do you mean it was too small?
There were only 35 full-time faculty members, right?
Wow, only 35.
I was the only historian on the faculty.
So you literally were the history department.
I was.
Was there a historian there before you?
Yes, there had been.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. So yeah. You were like kind of replacing the.
Yes. Yeah. Somebody, he got a job as some kind of lectureship position at Brandeis, I think. So, but it wasn't like a regular, you know, tenure track kind of deal. But.
So what were you thinking in that summer after the first year, survival wise, were you thinking like I should maybe be looking at the job market again? Or were you thinking like, I'll hold on to this and see what happens? Or where was your state of mind?
I was applying, but my son had started to go to public school. We live right outside of Worcester, Massachusetts.
Yep.
So that's the other thing too, that was killing me, is that it was basically between, about an hour and 5 to 90 minute commute each way. It was 4 days a week. I didn't have to teach on Fridays, but, that commute was kind of brutal, and the public transportation up here is awful. So there is a commuter rail I could have taken, but it was like, to buy a monthly pass was like almost $500 a month. I was like, what?
Yeah.
It was awful. Mm-hmm. But I was applying for jobs, but I was limiting it to, you know, Massachusetts, you know, Northern Connecticut, you know, because I just didn't want to uproot my family again. And I also, you know, when I finished my postdoc and before this Newberry thing came up, I very much had in mind teaching at some, and I actually had a few, like an interview or two at some fancy, like private schools in the New York City area. So teaching secondary had definitely been on my mind as not really the backup plan. You know, I could have seen myself going right into that without, you know, blinking an eye.
Me too. I was applying for private high schools and kind of starting to understand that whole, because it's a separate circuit to work, you know, it's a separate kind of air. It's kind of, and we've talked about this on the show before. You find a new language of applying for these jobs because it's a different set of skills to teach secondary school. How did you transition? Because it seems like you're kind of, well, I mean, I guess we'll get to that. We'll get to the transition.
Right.
Let's get to the crash first.
Yeah.
Is it during your second year that the school closes?
No, my third.
Third. Okay.
In my third year. There.
So you had, it seems like you had a kind of agonizing back and forth.
Yeah. Well, the second year, it became much more apparent how dire the school's finances were. I mean, they had, within the third year, they basically burned through what was left of the endowment just to keep the doors open for the first semester of the third year. And they really, all hail to the CFO, of who really through smoke and mirrors and various lending was able to carry through the final semester. But the second year I was like, oh wow, okay, this is really possible. And
is this
also
because, what is the root cause of this? Is it because no one, like the student enrollment was down, or why is the place going broke?
Enrollment. It had no real endowment to speak of. It had a very small endowment to after the 2007, 2008 financial crash.
One's enrolling because what? There's not an interest in going to small private liberal arts colleges anymore, and they're too expensive. That's my guess.
Well, it's. One of the sort of competitive advantages of Newberry was that it had this kind of career prep thing, and it was relatively cheap, and you could live on campus and everything, but it had no other option but to keep on raising tuition for in the post financial crisis period.
Yeah,
the time you know, in my last, you know, unbeknownst to me, like when I finally pulled the kid aside and I was like, really, what are you paying for? Like, you know, I knew this kid was paying a full ride, but at the same time, you know, most of the kids are from the inner city. So they're getting huge tuition reductions and in some cases scholarships. So, you know, the average student had like a 50% tuition reduction, but at the same time, like full room and board and everything was getting close to like 40 grand a year.
Dude. Yeah.
So, and I felt real qualms about that because, you know, they're just getting saddled with this tremendous amount of debt for a degree from a school that's really not known by anybody. Right. And, you know,
I guess my question kind of is like, how typical is Newberry? Will this happen at all at a lot of other, can other small colleges like Newberry expect to have the same kind of phenomenon?
I think it's going, you're going to see, it's so cyclical and weird, and I don't know. And it's all so specific to various institutions. I think you'll see more of the, like, I don't think it's possible for a school anymore that's really tuition driven, that only has like under 1,000 students, to really exist anymore. It's just not going to, it can't fly. It's just the costs are too much for operating the institution. And you need an endowment. You need a very strong, most of the schools that are kind of on the margins, the ones that have been able to pull it off. And I know, a dean at a school, who I have been friends with for a long time. Online is a huge, you know, I think online education in general is kind of a scam.
Yeah. it's clearly going to be used to kind of further the, you know, erosion of secure labor in higher education. Right. Yeah,
absolutely. And, but beyond that, it's, you know, it's a real profit center, particularly master's degrees and stuff. We barely had any grad programs at all. And they totally screwed up and just missed off the timing with the online stuff. So, you know, the only real revenue stream the school had was tuition. So, but it's interesting, but why did the enrollment fall off after I think the financial crash is something we're going to all, you know, historians writing 50, 60 years from now are going to see how momentous it really was and the shifts that it caused in American culture.
Dude, that's why they can come to this program for the academic end of it, I guess, and other ends of it, because that's totally what we're trying to track, is like knowing that, as historians, knowing that future generations of historians will be looking at this era as absolutely transformational in every way. And I wanted to just like mention really quickly, like you're talking about, like, because I think it's a really important point, the like idea of a classroom in its best potential can be like a non-capitalist space. But the problem is that these classrooms exist within institutions that are run by capitalist values. And like Newberry seems like it was one of those where you have like this great set of students, teachers, administrators doing all they can to create this really kind of amazing, you know, social space for students and everyone to be learning in, but they're subject to this like horrific economy, and those rules ruin it for everybody.
Right. And, you know, and I'm not going to say the school was some kind of utopia. It wasn't. I mean, it was deeply flawed in many ways, and the student experience was kind of subpar, but, you know, most of the students were first-gen students, so they kind of didn't know any better. So I, you know, part of me felt qualms about that there was almost, you know, a kind of predatory aspect to it. But
interesting. But
at the same time, you know, I think, you know, most of the faculty there really kind of delivered the goods and really like, this is how you write, you know, just basically taking kids who were so raw coming out of like the Boston public school systems or other kind of more immigrant working class cities around Boston, where the schools are, you know, just atrocious. It's funny, Massachusetts has this great reputation for public school education, but
yeah. You know,
but if you go to like these post-industrial cities like Brockton or Lowell, where a lot of my kids were coming from, the schools are just awful. They're really, I mean, atrocious. And one of the reasons the scores are so high for Massachusetts is because all of the bougie, super rich, wealthy suburbs around Boston, around the ring roads around Boston are just, you know, the public education that they get there is like at Lexington or Wellesley is comparable to, you know, first or second year of college in a really good school. You know what I mean? It's
massive inequality in that system.
Yeah, huge.
But
huge.
Didn't CUNY prepare you for that, right? Like CUNY is a place where, you know, I feel like it's an institution of many contradictions. But one of the kind of I think most. I don't know, the thing that drew me and you and others to CUNY was its original institutional mission, and we found we found that important, and like kind of there was a real pride, real working class pride in being the person that was quote unquote in the CUNY trenches, you know, swinging it out for our students. You know, it felt like, you know, we're actually, in other words, the kind of all the institutional difficulties and navigating it was part of like what made us a robust school. And made the experience a challenging and really valuable one.
Absolutely. And I really enjoyed my time as like a writing fellow, right? Like actually learning about writing pedagogy and how do you take English language learners, how do you take, you know, students with really rudimentary skills who, you know, were basically told they shouldn't be in college, and now, you know, how do you take them and empower them and show them how to use writing to writing to learn kind of philosophy.
My most nostalgic years in graduate school in a lot of ways was my writing fellowship years, because doing exactly that.
And it was a space that, you know, I guess most grad programs don't provide, to really think about pedagogy in a way that
that's a dirty secret. There's not enough teaching, training, and the kind of professional development that usually happens with people that are already in their tenure track jobs. Like it feels like you talk about like the level of teaching that we had to do at CUNY. I mean, I was like, I had never taught anything before in my life. And they were like, okay, here's three classes on American history at Brute College. And I was like, I mean, it was learning while walking, right? I was just in the classroom failing a teacher until I figured out what to do. That part of it. But I want to get back to your story. So at what point do they drop the bomb on you that the college is no more and you're going to have to figure out something else for yourself and your family, et cetera? That nightmare moment.
Yeah, it was the end of the fall semester in my third and final year at Newberry. It was literally the moment that grades would do.
In December, like right before the holiday.
And like it was Thursday evening, I got an email from the president's office saying, you know, all hands on deck, everybody come in on noon on Friday, right before the winter break starts. And you know that's good, right? But no, there were intimations. I mean, the president, this guy Joseph Chillo, was pretty open that fall, like that we were on the brink. I mean, we all knew, but he and, you know, several of the administrators were looking for potential buyers for the schools. Some of them sounding not so appealing. Others more so, or mergers, or you know, there was some kind of hope. You know, maybe
we're going to become a Nike Town outlet. Congratulations. You work at Nike now.
No, like there was this one like overseas European like private education conglomerate that sounded pretty neoliberal, scary, like whatever. And I was like, you know, if I have a job for a year or two after this, you know, because of that, then fine. There was a pall, and I felt bad. They admitted a class, you know, that fall, a new class that fall. And I felt really bad for those first year students because, you know, when that was announced, they were like, oh my God. But
how did you talk to students about this? Like, I would imagine students would be really upset. To me, it's always uncomfortable talking about like labor issues and stuff with students. I think it's a really important conversation to have, but like, were they upset? I mean, how did that go down?
Yeah, they were pretty upset, especially the first year students. But the thing is, most of the students who were aware were not fully surprised. The thing, like one of my favorite students, who I talked, she was one of the two, Vinny Delgadillo, who I interviewed in for the piece. She really saw the closure of Mount Ida at the end of the spring. Mount Ida College was just literally like 2 or 3 miles away from us, kind of a similar setup as Newberry. They announced their closure like 3 weeks before the end of the spring semester to close, right? So when that happened, a lot of the juniors and seniors were like, oh my God, yeah, this is very possible that this is going to happen to Newberry. But, you know, like I said, like a lot of the first gen students, they, you know, the idea that a college would close just seems so foreign and bizarre to them. And,
it seems, you know, foreign and bizarre to me, honestly, when I heard this. And I, like, dude, I've been, you know, running this podcast about these issues in part for many years. Yeah. So like, I've heard lots of crazy stories. But when I heard that Brandon O'Malley was working at a school that closed, and I don't remember where I heard that on social media somewhere, I was shocked. I was like, I didn't think that could happen.
Yeah, no. And you know, it just, you know, the colleges are supposed to be these repositories where your records are kept and employers will later, you know, you'll need your transcript for, you know, whatever. And, you know, so it was actually, that was really surreal. Some of the logistics of, like, I think Lesley College agreed to take all the Newberry records so that when, you know, students are applying to grad school or whatever, this is where the transcript, because it's gone.
In my head, and I could be wrong, but is it like a brick buildings, like cool campus, Newberry College? Like,
it's really small. It's under 8 acres, but I talk about this in the piece. It's this little, like I call it, this little working class island on top of this hill, the Fisher Hill neighborhood in Brookline.
It's romantic already to me.
Yeah, but it is. But they bought over time. The Edward Tassinari, the guy who founded the school, was completely entrepreneurial and was able to get enough money. And he built all these, this program where all these satellite campuses, and he was raking in money during like the 70s and 80s and 90s. This guy was, he was a, you know, but he, when he stepped down, it was kind of tied to this one guy. I mean, the success of the place, and it was this little mom and pop shop. But when he stepped down, that's when everything seemed to have gone awry for it. But I mean, he wasn't like an academic. He wasn't really.
This is the guy that started the school, or?
But he really pissed off the neighbors by buying this campus when it came up for sale. It's a extremely wealthy neighborhood. There are these huge mansions, around it. And, you know, like the quarterback for the New England Patriots, I mentioned, Tom Brady, has a mansion in the neighborhood, as does the owner of the Patriots, Robert Kraft, who, and, you know, despite being a New Englander, I can't stand.
It sounds like you could film a David Fincher movie in this neighborhood. Gothic New England.
They're all the neighborhood was designed by Olmsted, right? They're all like around 1890s, 1910s, you know, kind of buildings in that neighborhood. And they're beautiful. And it's very hilly, and there are these winding hills. And then there's just weird, like 60s style building campus, you know, and that's the heart of the campus. But then Tassinari did buy some of the surrounding mansions for classroom space and stuff like that. So it's kind of a weird mishmash. But for a while, it was a Catholic women's college. That's what I think these buildings date from, the sort of 60s academic stuff. And there is, like, you know, the sort of this Catholic subtle hints that it's like Catholic 60s institutional architecture. You know, in the main academic.
Now, what happens to those buildings now that the place is closed?
Well, the sale of the campus just went through. I think it was for about $35 million, which will erase all the school's debt. I think the school had something like $10 or $12 million in outright debt, and then a couple other, you know, things here and there. It went to a developer who, you know, this is our future, is going to create luxury like old folks homes.
No fucking way. Oh my God, dude. Like the reason I wanted to have you tell this story is because it's such a, like, your story is one that is a kind of, like, I don't know. I think it's a very common one in the sense of, like, trying to navigate a PhD in history and in the kind of, like, post crash era. But also like, you know, just the details like that. I mean, unbelievable. Yeah. This is just kind of like the world we're living in. I mean, I just was tweeting this morning about, like, telepresence technology and kind of one of the schools I'm at is kind of training me on how to use this room that, like, has walls that are projectors. And it basically makes, like, the room bigger by adding in projected images of other classrooms filled with students live. And so in other words, it gives the illusion that I'm in a big, big room filled with students, but it's really a kind of pastiche of different rooms being projected into my room. And really, like, I was just like, this is the future. This is a kind of that direction of technology that was supposed to kind of liberate everyone is instead kind of clearly being used to cut labor costs here. Because what this is you remember the kind of when we were in graduate school, MOOCs were big, right? Like kind of like this idea that we were going to have like one guy at Harvard teach a class with 10,000 students. And that quickly like, you know, went away as a fad. But it seems like they're achieving that already.
Yeah. No, but the, like the stuff with projecting the students behind you. And oh, my God, it's like worse than anything Philip K. Dick imagined.
It's crazy.
It's insane. It's insane.
But, well, you talk about that like non-capitalist space, you know,
right.
Like, how do I have that when I'm like in this kind of like brought to you by Bank of America room that is just tricked out with tech that kind of, I mean, I don't know. And what part of me was kind of amazed by how much the tech has improved. And part of me was kind of like, this is as far from that romantic notion of a non-capitalist space as I can get.
And to be honest, you know, I almost shame myself for even thinking along those terms, because it was never a non-capitalist space for my students, because they're going to, even the ones, I feel really bad for the ones who weren't able to, I think you needed for the school, unlike Mount Ida, which totally just left everybody hanging. Newberry, that last semester, my boss, the dean of faculty and the dean of student affairs and all these other folks worked their asses off to set up transfer agreements to other schools. But if you had a GPA below, I think it was like 2.0, you were screwed and you were just saddled with a huge amount of debt. So
wow.
The idea.
Yeah, I was going to ask like what happens to, because you're talking about what happens to the buildings, but what happens to the students and what happens to the administrators?
Yeah. Well, the administrators, they all landed, I think, pretty well.
In like other jobs somewhere.
Yeah.
Okay, good.
The people I worry about are like the janitorial staff.
Yeah. I mean, that's what I'm thinking about. It's just like everybody that works there. I mean, these schools employ a lot of people.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, there was only, really, it was such a small place. It was just like probably a couple hundred, including like, you know, janitors and administrators and, you know, the whole admissions office and, you know, most of the admissions staff, they were pretty young kids right out of college. And, you know, a lot of them kind of petered away very quickly. You know, obviously once you're not going to admit, it was actually cool though. The ones who were still looking for work were, they were transfer counselors instead of being admissions people.
Right, right. Yeah. No, that makes sense.
The fly kind of creative things.
So there was a transition period where everyone's kind of like, I don't know, kind of getting out of the school and trying to make it as smooth as possible for everyone.
Yeah, but it's such without precedent in many ways that it was just, and it's surreal. Like this, like the whole notion of a college and the branding of the college and the, you know, the fundraising efforts, and, you know, it's supposed to be sort of in perpetuity, or at least, as I say in the piece, it's supposed to outlive you, you know what I mean, a college. So the idea of like putting this thing down, even though the original founder, he's in his 80s now, he outlasted the college.
It's disturbing. There's definitely a disturbing element to it. And I mean, isn't like this happening? I feel like I should follow. I need to follow it more. But, you know, with like the universities in Alaska, I feel like we've seen like the dramatically downsized, and they're talking about cutting, closing departments, especially in the humanities. Yeah. And like seeing that is like, you know, it's one thing to kind of like see that and be like, OK, that's the end of a certain romantic notion of education. But it's really more than that, because what we see and then what you and I know as CUNY people is like the access to higher education, if it's only for people that have a lot of money, then, you know, you're dooming a whole a huge section of the population to this kind of to this kind of existence. And it's just I don't know. It's depressing to be by that part of it. Yeah. So the other part of it was I wanted to hear, you know, your survival story. So how did you transition out of that and into teaching secondary school? Was it something that, I mean, I know you're kind of in the midst of that now, but how did that happen?
Well, you know, I come from a family of public school educators. So, I mean, last fall it was, you know, things looked grim enough for Newberry that I went ahead and took the licensure test. to become a high school, you know, social studies teacher in Massachusetts. So I, you know, started the practice, I started the process really, the summer.
It was a defensive move.
Yeah, it was, but at the same time, and I got, you know, it's much less formal than Interfolio, but there's, for public school educators, is something called School Spring, which is this website, which is kind of like Interfolio Junior. It's not as quite torturous as the whole Interfolio process. And School Spring, I applied for oh my gosh, probably about I would say 300 to 400 jobs.
No, really?
Like in Massachusetts, but maybe not
at all high schools.
But almost 300, yeah.
All high schools.
Like, but I was only licensed for Massachusetts. But I like from one end of the state to the other. I mean, maybe 300 is even an exaggeration, but at least like somewhere.
Let me ask you this. How did you get the license? Did you have to? Because I always imagined to get my license in California to transfer from being like a PhD historian teaching college to someone teaching high school. Do I have to go to school for that? Do I have to go get trained? How did you do that?
Well, it varies from licensure, varies from state to state. Mm-hmm. The process, Massachusetts is a pretty high bar. Most of the time you need to go through some sort of teacher training program. For me, taking the history license test, you know, for both, which it combined US and world, was, you know, it was, I could have written the test. I mean, you know, having a PhD in history,
right.
Need to be arrogant, but I knew more than the people who were writing the test. You know what I mean?
Yeah, right.
And some of the questions were a little bit dated in terms of the historiography and everything. But here I am being the arrogant prick academic about it. But
these were not woke questions. Right. Some of them were not in line with the current historiography.
Right, but I knew what the right answer they were looking for. But a lot of people fail that test. You know, it's a pretty high level test, and I didn't find it challenging. But that's because, you know, I had been studying this stuff for 10 years. So
are you applying for looking for specifically history teaching jobs?
Yeah,
right.
So, yeah. Mm-hmm. Exactly. So I got my license fairly easily. I didn't even have to study for the test. But now, so that's how you actually get to apply. But the other thing that most districts are looking for is the sheltered English immersion endorsement. And I'm studying to take a test for that because I need that. I need to have that in place before the end of my first year or I lose my job. And that is really a kind of bullshit a test to say that you do certain strategies for English language learners, right?
Right.
Because the state was a part of a group of states that got sued for not doing right by English language learners. So it's kind of a stopgap measure. But the test is painful and has a horrible reputation. But I'm going to take it in October, and that I actually have to study really hard for. My sister, who's been teaching middle school in Braintree, a city outside of Boston, she's going into her 22nd or 23rd year now. She just took it and she failed it. I mean, it was because it's all theory. That has nothing to do with the actual practical classroom, you know, it actually studying for it, it's actually taught me some strategies that I might use, but it's just, you have to jump through a lot of these bureaucratic hoops. But anyway, so I applied for seriously, probably, I'm not exaggerating, about 250 jobs. It felt like 400 jobs, but it's pretty easy on the School Spring thing. It's not like you have to request individualized letters. You just have standard letters that you can use. I got very few nibbles because they don't want academics and teaching in public schools.
That's what I found. You know, that's what I found. That I suspected that, and I felt like, you know, I'm going to be the low man on the totem pole in terms of these applications just by virtue of the fact that I have a PhD.
Right. Yeah. And they definitely look askance at it. And not only do you not have the right, you know, teacher skills, but you're expensive because most places do have a ladder that, and if you have a doctorate, you immediately start at the top of the pay ladder. Right. So I was really fortunate. I got a couple interviews, mostly for like 1 year positions, right. For like temp, somebody goes on maternity leave or something like that. And then I finally, this job came up at this place called the University Park Campus School, which was founded in the 90s by the Education Department and Worcester Public Schools as a partnership at Clark University. And there was a lot of politics around Clark University. Clark University is located in, you know, Worcester is the second biggest city in Massachusetts, and I think in all of New England after Boston. It's a pretty size. It's about 130,000 people or something like that. It's not a huge city, but it's Roy Rosenzweig's book, 8 Hours for What They Will, is a study of like working class 19th, early 20th century Worcester. And it is, and it's kind of like New York City in that it's the manufacturing economy has declined, but it's never quite fully gone away. There's still a fairly robust manufacturing economy here. And so tons of immigrants still come here. We have, but this school, the University Park Campus School, they have a little more leeway. And since it's affiliated with the university, I guess the principal told me I was some kind of like innovation hire, right? You know, bring some.
There's that neoliberal language.
Yeah, I know. Exactly.
That's great. I mean, to me, like there's a lot of different elements to your story, but yeah. I think that people can learn from it. I mean, in terms of like jumping through bureaucratic hoops and finding your kind of place in terms of like, just recognizing that like teaching is something that you can do and that you want to do, honest with yourself about that. Cause I feel like a lot of people try to force themselves into thinking that they want to be teachers when they don't really. But either way, I mean, your story ultimately is I don't want to be cheesy, but it's a hopeful one in the sense of like you're making it and you're teaching in a place that it sounds like a valuable place.
Yeah, it is. No, it is. And it's, I think the way that I was kind of able to sort of sell my CUNY experience and having, the experience of, I detest the language that they use, but, taught with lots of diversity and, a lot of, all of that kind of, but it's true.
I mean, CUNY trenches prepare you for any kind of teaching. They really do.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Do. And, but I really, I adore the students at this school. A lot of them are coming from some fairly traumatic situations, but I mean, we have immigrants from, Ethiopia. We have immigrants from the Caribbean, the families, a very large Vietnamese community,
It sounds like, I mean, you've got a version of the kind of CUNY impulse. I love that you wound up, working with, an immigrant population because it seems like it's such a vital part of your kind of identity as a person, but also as a scholar.
I mean,
finish that Castle Garden book, Brandon. We got it. We want to see that.
No, and I question like there's the whole sort of white savior thing that.
Of course, it's always there, dude.
Which is painful to think about, and it's funny
better than like, a fucking white fascist or any of the other like iterations of a white man that you could be in America. And if you're like the Atticus Finch, that's not the worst thing to be,
right? But it is. And I am a socialist Atticus Finch.
There you go.
Yeah, but the thing, race, the question of race and the sort of positionality that I put it out there with my CUNY students, with my Newberry students, and in a kind of softer way with the high school students as well. Like, what do you guys feel like? At Newberry, I had this kind of absurd situation. It was fabulous. It turned out to be one of the best discussions we had. But how do you feel about this white guy teaching you guys about African American history? You know what I mean? So it was
those kinds of conversations.
They're amazing. They're amazing. And, it's funny because my scholarly work on Castle Garden, just to sum that up really quickly.
Yeah, please.
The big takeaway that I came from, what it is that from 1855 to 1890, there was this precursor to Ellis Island called the Castle Garden Immigrant Depot at the base of Battery Park, right? What's now called Castle Clinton used to have, it was like this processing center where about 8 million people came through between, 1855 and 1890.
8 million, like right there at the bottom tip of Manhattan.
Yes. Yeah.
And right in the middle of the 19th century. And as I understand it, is this like the first like big immigration like facility in America?
Yeah. Anywhere.
Yeah. Anywhere.
Really? I mean, I haven't found anything else quite like it. But the thing that Ellis Island was a lot of the people who worked at Castle Garden actually got hired at Ellis Island. So there was a little bit of a overlap in the practice, but there was much more of a emphasis on exclusion. With Castle Garden, there was a little bit of that. And I Hidetaka Hirota's book, Expelling the Poor, he sees it as more exclusionary than I do. It was actually more of a welfare state for immigrants, right? Really helped to prop them up and get them to where they were going, and largely to get them out of the city as quickly as possible, where their labor was worth more, and you know, where land was cheaper, and it was more of like a transportation hub, but also it had elaborate like hospital facilities, and you could base and they charged the steamship companies and the older, you know, sailing ship companies to support this, right?
So are you saying that it's like it's more humane than Ellis Island?
You know, it's institutional, and all institutional things have an inhuman side, and there was lots of corruption there too. But what I'm saying is that it was a welfare state for immigrants. So old notion that my white ancestors didn't have any help from the state to get here, they did it all by themselves, is bullshit. Because it was fairly meager in terms of, you know, I think calling it a welfare state might be exaggerating a little bit, but it really, you know, welfare for white people basically disappears.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah. Well, I mean, and it's to me, that's such an important history to kind of reverse what we began this conversation talking about, that romantic notion of the Ellis Island immigrant as kind of like the prototypical immigrant. And I mean, I don't know if you've seen the like Rick Burns New York documentary, but there's a moment. I think it's David McCullough, like speaking of the New York Historical Society, but like he's an old fashioned type of, you know, nationalist historian. And he tells this story of like, you know, when the boats would come into the New York Harbor, all of the immigrants would come to one side of the boat, and the boat would lean over and list as they all stared in awe at the Statue of Liberty. And I'm like, how do you know that happened? And did that always happen? In other words, he has a very, very romantic vision of the immigrant experience. Yeah.
Yeah. And you know, going back to the consensus era of, you know, the mid 20th century, there was a real nostalgia for that, you know, pre 1924. But it once again, to get back to the state, bringing the state back into immigration history, 1924. Think about what else was going on. You know, height of the second Klan, the ideas of, you know, Lothrop Stoddard and all this, you know, white supremacist bullshit that was
the second, you know, KKK.
But let's keep all of and that was legit. Let's keep all of these questionable, like, you know, Sicilians and Eastern European Jews. They're not what we want here. They're not white enough. And you know, we can kind of tolerate the Irish and the Germans, but we can't tolerate these folks. And you know, and so,
and
you know,
in other words, that's important because the state operation towards those folks becomes more oppressive.
Right. And you just can't get in anymore. In 1924 is the beginning of our modern visa system. And Ellis Island shuts down completely as a processing site in 1924 and really just becomes a detention center at 1924. So it actually becomes more in line with Angel Island, which opens in 1910 in San Francisco Bay, which is where you know, Chinese immigrants coming in who claim to have some kind of right to get into the country. I mean, most people who came to Angel Island were denied rather than let in. So Ellis Island kind of falls in line with Angel Island in 1924.
Wow. It's such an important part of the like kind of larger story. I you know, you mentioned Carl Linskog, who I think, you know, I'm jealous of the relevance of his stuff is so powerful, because I think his book is like out in paperback now. Like they've already done it. They're already doing another printing of it. Speaking of the publishing industry.
Yeah. University of Florida Press, I think, did his book.
Well, unpacking all that stuff is part of, I think, why, I don't know, you and I and all the people that we went to the CUNY Graduate Center, we all had a kind of similar take on why we are studying history. I feel like so many of us were, those conversations that we're nostalgic about are in part political conversations about what was going on, you know, around us right there, you know, in the slice of history that we occupied at the CUNY Graduate Center. But anyway, I think the point I was making is that all of us as historians are, I think, similar in the sense that we're trying to make connections to like our current moment. And your work on Castle Garden really does that. And I really hope you continue working on it and finish it. I know that like now that you're working in the secondary school system, you have probably even less time to do it. But we're all kind of, I think, working on that reality is like, how do you hybridize and do it all at once? It's not easy.
No. And there's not a lot of space to do scholarship, but I'm behind submitting an article for the Journal of the Early American Republic. I'm supposed to have done that September 1, but I'm like, just prepping. That's the thing about being a public school educator is the prep is just relentless.
I'm sure.
It's every day. And it's really, I'm still figuring how to balance that out. And, but just one little bit of GC nostalgia I just want to tell you.
Please.
The day of my orals examination, the comprehensive exam,
yep.
I was such an arrogant prick at that time. I invited David Harvey to be on my orals committee.
No. And, why would yeah. you do that to yourself?
I don't know. I was so – and he ended up asking me this totally insane question about lawnmowers. It was utterly insane.
What was
insane.
The question?
Basically, why in the post-war period? Like, what's going on with lawnmowers? Why do lawnmowers
– Yeah, oh, that is sinister.
I talked about suburbanization and everything. And, I kind of did some kind of stupid answer about suburbanization. But the thing that terrified me when he came in, it was the day of the stock market crash.
Holy shit, man.
And he came in, he walked in with this big smile on his face, and he said, like, my Tia Kreff account. And he was the last person to come into the room. And here I am terrified. It's my orals, right? He said, my Tia Kreff account just lost about, I think he said something like $100,000 or something like that.
Amazing.
And he was like laughing with this like maniacal whatever.
Yeah, I don't know why you would do that to yourself, because David Harvey is an incredibly intimidating figure, and there were like a whole bunch of them. I mean, I did not invite James Oakes onto my orals, in part because I heard that if people listening don't know who James Oakes is, he's written a number of books about American slavery, and he was our right. like at our school, he was the slavery dude. I mean, and I had heard that he liked to, in certain people's orals, that he liked to, like, for one of his questions, he would just ask, what is slavery? Like, that's it.
Right.
And to me, like, that was just like, I don't need that in my life.
No,
I don't
no.
need that kind of stress. But lawnmower from David Harvey sounds equally insane.
It was insane. It was just stupid. And
I feel like I could bullshit it, though. You know, lawnmowers. All right, let's go.
Yeah.
But Brendan O'Malley, thank you so much. I really appreciate you taking the time from your now it seems even busier life. But I really appreciate you telling your story, because I think it's a really important one for people that are thinking about, what it's like to be a history PhD in the 21st century. So thank you.
Yeah, no, thank you, David. It was a lot of fun. And I'm glad that you thought the contingent piece was worthwhile. And just a shout out to the contingent people. I mean, I wrote that in a very raw emotional state, and I gave them like two versions, and those guys like really worked it over and did, and I just, if you have any extra money at all, give it to
yeah,
the contingent.
I would like to back that up, because the contingent people, I mean, we've had Aaron Bartram and Bill Black on the show a couple times, but I feel like that really is, they really are pointing to what the future is for generations of historians and other academics that are making our way and taking care of each other. So again, thank you. We'll talk to you soon.
Okay. Thanks again, David.
Okay. I want to thank Brendan O'Malley for coming on the show and sharing his story. It's not an easy one to share, I know, but I think it's a really important one for all of us to learn from, because, this is the world we're in now. This is the world that historians certainly are coming to terms with. And I think some of our most the episodes of the Nostalgia Trap that have gotten some of the biggest reactions, honestly, have been of historians from this generation who are trying to navigate these waters. And we're all doing it differently, but we're all helping each other out. So support your independent historians wherever you can. We're struggling. We're a struggling class of people right now, but we're trying to put our stuff out there and make it worthwhile. And that's what the Nostalgia Trap is too. So if you go to patreon.com/nostalgiatrap, you can support this historian. And we have bonus material and other stuff for those that are doing that. Really appreciate it. We will talk to you again next week. Take care. Bye-bye.